Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and welcome to this, our International Women's Day concert for 2021. Last year, we ran a week of events celebrating female achievements, but also raising that very poignant question about gender bias and gender inequality. And whilst we have obviously been in lockdown, this hasn't escaped our minds at this stage of the year. And we have therefore decided that it would be a lovely collaboration between many of the departments in the college to produce such a concert for this evening. It's often said that a challenged world is an alert world, and individually, of course, we are always responsible for our actions and, of course, our thinking all the time, every day, all day. However, we can always challenge these thoughts and actions. And one of the most seminal issues in today's world is, of course, that of gender bias and of gender inequality. And at any stage, we can call these out. And we're always here to celebrate, of course, the wonderful achievements of women. And this can be taken no further, of course, than the four walls of Ardingly College. As you will see this evening, some wonderful performances, not exclusively from girls in the college. However, we can, through all of these media, create a far more inclusive and equal world. So, on to tonight's concert then. As I mentioned, we have a truly, truly far-reaching set of contributions, and this is maybe our first real collaborative effort across many of the faculties in a co-curricular capacity. We have wonderful artwork and photography work. We have some amazing reading and poetry from our English department and the students there. Of course, we have dramatic contributions from some of our actors, and there's a bit of music in there as well. We have a couple of surprises. I'm not going to spoil those now, but we have a couple of other things put in the mix. But the culminating feature, I think, of tonight's concert has been a project which has been led by Susan Gilmore-Bailey, our head of singing, which has been our collective performance of a work called 21st Century Woman, which was written by the very eminent composer Joanna Forbes Lestrange. And this has been a truly impressive undertaking, as we have tried to learn and record this song virtually. I believe we have about 50 videos or so, which obviously Ben Freer, the wizard that he is, has spliced together. But we've also had a chance to meet Joanna and have a workshop with her and take away some tricks of the trade, but also her amazing energy and passion for this subject, but of course music in general. And just a little bit about this song. This was based on Oprah Winfrey's 2018 Golden Globes acceptance speech. And Joanna first released this rather poignantly on the 8th of March 2019, and it was released across various media platforms, and this was a recording made in Abbey Road Studios by an all-female cast, of course. And I don't want to spoil the meaning of the song, but I imagine you can work out what its sentiment is, and we might be catching up with Joanna a little bit later. So that will be the culminating item of this concert. But all it leaves me to say is actually something slightly different to my usual introductions to these concerts, which is, of course, from challenge comes change. And therefore, let's choose to challenge these inequalities and these differences, but also, another C word, let's celebrate. And tonight, I hope you enjoy this performance and this set of wonderful efforts from students and teachers alike to celebrate the diversity and wonderful achievements of women. So make sure you've got something to eat, make sure you've got something to drink, and I'll see you on the other side. Bye for now. Thank you.
Queen Elizabeth I's Tilbury speech. My faithful and loving people, we have been persuaded by some that are careful of our safety to take heed how we commit ourselves to armed multitudes for fear of treachery. But I assure you that I do not desire to live to distrust my faithful and loving people. Let tyrants fear. I have always behaved myself so that under God, I have placed my chiefest strength and safeguard in the loyal hearts and open minds of my subject. And therefore, I am come amongst you, as you see at this time, not for my recreation or my disport, but being resolved in the midst and the heat of the battle to live and to die amongst you all, to lay down for my God, for my kingdom, for my people, my honour and my blood, even in the dust. But I know that I have the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and the stomach of a king, and of a king of England too, and think foul scorn of Parma and Spain and any other prince that dares to invade the borders of my realm. To which, rather than any dishonor shall grow by me, I myself will take up arms. I myself will be your general, your judge, and the rewarder of all of your virtues in the field. And I know already for your forwardness that you deserve rewards and crowns. And we do assure you, on word of a prince, that these shall be duly paid. But in the meantime, my lieutenant general shall be in my stead, than whom never a prince commanded a more worthy or noble subject as he. So, not doubting, but by your obedience, by your concord in the camp, and by your valour in the field, we shall soon have a famous victory over these enemies of God.
When day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, the sea we must wade. We've braved the belly of the beast. We've learnt that quiet isn't always peace, and the norms and notions of what just is isn't always just is. And yet the dawn is ours. Before we knew it, somehow we do it. Somehow we've weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We, the successors of a country and a time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves and raised by a single mother, can dream of becoming president, only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from polished, far from pristine, but that doesn't mean we are striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge a union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colours, characters and conditions of man. And so we lift our gazes not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know to put our future first, we must first put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so we can reach out our arms to one another. We seek harm to none and harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, say this is true. That even as we grieved, we grew. That even as we hurt, we hoped. That even as we tired, we tried. That we'll forever be tied together, victorious. Not because we will never again know defeat, but because we will never again sow division. Thank you.
This is an extract from a book called A Thousand Ships by Natalie Haynes. Natalie Haynes is a writer who seeks to retell stories, classical myths and stories from a female perspective. And this extract is in the voice of Calliope, who is the muse for epic poetry. If he tells me to sing one more time, I think I might bite him. The presumption of these men is extraordinary. Does he believe I have nothing else to do with my time than sit around being his muse? His. When did poets forget that they serve the muses, not the other way around? And if he can remember new lines of verse during his recitations, why can't he remember to say please? Does everyone have to die? He asks, plaintive like a child. Perhaps he thought he was writing about one of those other wars. Devastation is what happens in wars. It is its nature. I murmur to him in his dreams sometimes. I do have other things to do, but I like how he looks when he sleeps. You knew Achilles would die. You knew Hector would die before him. You knew Patroclus would die. You've told their stories before. If you didn't want to think of men cut down in battle, then why would you want to compose epic verse? Ah, but now I see the problem. It's not their deaths he's upset about. It's that he knows what's coming, and he's worrying it will be more tragedy than epic. I watch his chest rising and falling as he grabs a fitful rest. Men's deaths are epic. Women's deaths are tragic. Is that it? He has misunderstood the very nature of conflict. Epic is countless tragedies woven together. Heroes don't become heroes without carnage, and carnage has both causes and consequences, and those don't begin and end on a battlefield. If he truly wants to understand the nature of the epic story I am letting him compose, he needs to accept that the casualty of war aren't just the ones who die, and that a death off the battlefield can be more noble, more heroic, if he prefers it that way, than one in the midst of fighting. "But it hurts," he said, "when Kruusa died." He would rather her story had been snuffed out like a spark, failing to catch damp kindling. "It does hurt," I whispered. "It should hurt. She isn't a footnote. She's a person. And she, all the Trojan women, should be memorialised as much as any other person. Their Greek counterparts too. War is not a sport to be decided in a quick bout on a strip of contested land. It is a web which stretches out to the furthest parts of the world, drawing everyone into itself. I will teach him this before he leaves my temple, or he will have no poem at all.
Wellesley, 1983. In Spenser's The Faerie Queen, Book 3, there is a place called the Castle of Busy Rain, on whose outer gate is written, "Be bold," and on the second gate, "Be bold, be bold," and on the inner iron door, "Be not too bold." This is not the advice I am giving. I urge you to be as imprudent as you dare. Be bold, be bold. Be bold.
Little Red Cap by Carol Ann Duffy. At childhood's end, the houses petered out into playing fields, the factories, allotments kept, like mistresses by kneeling married men. The silent railway line, the hermit's caravan, till you came at last to the edge of the woods. It was there that I first clapped eyes on the wolf. He stood in a clearing, reading his verse out loud in his wolfy drawl, a paperback in his hairy paw, red wine stain in his bearded jaw. What big ears he had, what big eyes he had, what teeth! In the interval, I made quite sure he spotted me. Sweet 16, never been. Babe, waif, and bought me a drink, my first. You might ask why. Here's why. Poetry. The wolf, I knew, would lead me deep into the woods, away from home, to a dark, tangled, thorny place, lit by the eyes of owls. I crawled in his wake, my stocking ripped to shred, scrap of red from my blazer, snagged on a twig and branch. Murder clues. I lost both my shoes, but got there. Wolf's lair, better beware. Lesson 1, that night. Breath of the wolf in my ears was the love poem. I clung till dawn to his thrashing fur, for what little girl doesn't love a wolf? Then I slid from between his heavy, matted paws and went in search for a living bird, white dove, which flew straight from my hands to the hope mouth. One bite, dead. "How nice, breakfast in bed," he said, licking his chops. As soon as he slept, I crept to the back of the lair where the whole wall was crimson, gold, aglow with books. Words, words were truly alive on the tongue, in the head, warm, beating, frantic, winged, music and blood. But then I was young, and it took 10 years in the woods to tell that a mushroom stopper's the mouth of a buried corpse, that birds are the uttered thoughts of the trees, that a graying wolf howls the same old song at the moon year in, year out. Season after season, same rhyme, same reason. I took an axe to a willow to see how it wept. I took an axe to a salmon to see how it leapt. I took an axe to the wolf as he slept. One chop, scrotum to throat, and saw the glistening, virgin white of my grandmother's bones. I filled his belly with stones. I stitched him up. Out of the forest I come with my flowers, singing all alone. Thank you.
So we are delighted to be here this evening to have a conversation around some of the central topics of our discussions in New Era Ardingly's Feminist Society as part of this celebration of International Women's Day 2021. The theme this year is Choose to Challenge, and that is an integral part of our society's aim as we gather weekly to educate ourselves on the global issues of equality, gender and power, and to challenge ourselves and others to work towards positive change. And we are extremely grateful to our guest, celebrated actor, director, humanitarian, all-around Renaissance woman, Cate Blanchett, for joining us to discuss these important topics.
Okay, perfect. I'll ask my question first. So New Era Society has recently changed its name from Ardingly Feminist Society to be as inclusive as possible and reflect the intersectionality of feminism and the movement for equality. We were, however, initially a little concerned about losing the word feminism, as we think the word has a lot of power and it's very meaningful in its history. So we were just wondering, what are your thoughts on naming slash self-identification as a feminist, both for groups and for yourself? And do you actually feel comfortable calling yourself a feminist? And has this been something you have to work towards?
I feel like I'm suddenly transported back to being 16 at school when exactly the same question was being asked. Are you a feminist? Do you feel comfortable being a feminist? That is literally like a Groundhog Day. Look, I agree. I think language is incredibly powerful. And the whole point, I suppose, for me to identify, if that's the phrase, as being a feminist, is to acknowledge the fact that I wouldn't be here having the opportunities that I have without the women who have made enormous sacrifices and been incredible provocateurs for positive change who've come before me. So I feel it's acknowledging that history. But perhaps in the same vein about the idea of losing the name feminist, is I never think about my gender at all until a door is closed to me because of it. I've always thought that in my lifetime, I was hoping we'd reach a point where there was no need to identify as a feminist, because of course, in the 70s, with second wave feminism, the word became incredibly politicized. And for me, it's always been synonymous as the things you were referring to with the notions of equality. And I still do not understand how the notion of equality is a political issue. When the biggest so-called democracy, or what used to be the biggest democracy in the world, in America, when it's not accepted constitutionally, that equality is not enshrined in the constitution, then of course you can't, the laws that will emanate from that constitution will not be as inclusive as they could be. And I do think on a more immediate note, I think that the pandemic would have played out entirely differently if equality had been enshrined in the American constitution, because of course equality for me is bedrock in feminism, and I think it's a human issue. It's not just a, when in any place around the world that places subjugates women to men or to any other group, I think is not a civil society. And I, for one, want to live in a civil society. I want my boys as well as my daughter to live in a civil society. So yes, I do identify as a feminist, and I hope we reach a day when that word becomes irrelevant and just as part of sort of our everyday culture.
Yeah. So sort of following on from that and like the negativity surrounding the word feminism, we're kind of interested in like debunking these negative myths and stereotypes surrounding women and feminists specifically in New Era. And we were just wondering what your thoughts on sort of the myths and the tropes of female competitiveness, which has been used in the past as a reason that women can't effectively work together. And in your work on female cast and creative team productions like Ocean's 8, what has been your experience about the benefits of these female-centered spaces and collaborations? And did you actually face any challenges?
Wow. Now, you've got to remember, I have early onset dementia, and that is a big question. You might have to call me to task. Look, I think, you know, Gloria Steinem always complains about the catfight version of history, you know, that women are against one another. And I think if that has been at all true, it's because there's often only one, has been only one place, if that, at the table for a woman. And so women have been pitted against one another for that single opportunity. And of course, when you're the person, and I've been in many board meetings when I'm the only woman, I've been on set many, many times up until quite recently, where I would literally do a head count and I was one woman to 35 men. I was one woman to 60 men. And I'm talking about across departments, and I'm also talking about in front of screen. And so then the way you get marketed is you get placed in competition to one another. Who looks slimmer? Who looks better? Who's getting more work? Who's getting more paid? And of course, it creates this culture of paranoia. And I think what I've been so excited by, particularly over the last 3 or 4 years, is the fact that women are embracing our, you know, being incredibly collegiate and also making demands. That in fact, I want to work with a female director. I want to work with a female cinematographer. Why am I standing on set and why am I the only woman here? What is wrong with this picture? And it's not that I don't want to work with men. I love my male colleagues. But when you're in a room that is in any way homogenous, whether it's from a gender perspective or a race perspective or an age perspective, a cultural perspective, the conversation will become homogenous. And for me, in my industry, a creative industry, when you're in a diverse environment, the outcomes will be more surprising. So it behooves us creatively, behooves us as an industry, a progressive industry, and a very public industry to make those changes. And I mean, the other thing that Gloria Steinem also said is that women are linked, not ranked. And so I think that's something that I've always subscribed to. And I think that I played a woman called Phyllis Schlafly recently, who made it her life's mission to stop equality being enshrined in the American Constitution. And she also made it her mission to make sure that the word feminism became a dirty word, and that those who identified as a feminist were synonymous with being anti-family or anti-male or anti-female. And I think that of course that is playing into people's fears. And I think whenever you operate from a fear-based perspective, you move further and further away from the truth. And I think essentially women are collaborators rather than competitors. And, you know, women, as I said, are not a monolith. You know, you So there's many different types of women with many different types of ambition, you know. There's a huge, in the UK, there's a huge traditional women movement. Now, I don't know what that means. I think the way they would identify themselves is to be women who want to stay at home. And I think that where there was a misunderstanding with feminism is that it was that they were telling women you had to go out into the workforce. I don't think it's that at all. I just think it's about equality, not only of pay, but of opportunity. And so when there are more opportunities for women, the fact that the women will be less and less likely to be placed in the role of competitors.
Thank you so much. And you preempted my next question, which is the way that you seem to manage to balance such a variety of roles in your life, which I know is really hard to do. Theatre director, actor, UN Goodwill ambassador, parent. And obviously that is inspirational to many people. I know you say that for you, you know, the identifying through your gender was never a part of the way that you viewed or wanted to view yourself. But I wonder whether that was a conscious choice, whether this transcending of those narrow categories of what a woman can be was important to you. And, you know, did you set out or did you strive to achieve that? Was that like a conscious decision? I wonder whether you think it's easier, another long-winded question, sorry, for women to make art today, you know, without having to be in those kind of boxes before of single or wealthy or eccentric or other. Is it becoming easier for women to transcend those categories?
Well, I mean, in the first part of your question was about balance. Our lives are chaos. We have four children. We're both, my husband and I are both freelancers. We both are active parents, and we have many, many interests that, you know, we also want to fulfill, and we're very interested in our children's lives. So our life is never balanced. And I think that is kind of an extrapolation of, you know, certainly when I was in my 20s, and when women started to perhaps get more opportunities, not necessarily moving behind the camera, but maybe it's because I was moving more into the public eye, and was certainly happened to me when I became a mother, as if my personality was going to change entirely, and somehow being pregnant was an illness. And questions I found, I would be on, you know, doing press with my male counterparts who also had children. And there was like one box out of which all the questions were pulled for my male counterparts, and one box that was the questions that you ask women. And I just didn't sort of understand it at all. So, but I don't know that. So that was a very big question. And I don't know if I've necessarily.
Absolutely. Yeah. Just that idea, whether it was that kind of transcending of those categories was something that you consciously work towards or strive towards. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I grew up in a very strong female household. You know, my father passed away when I was young, and my mother had to go back to work. And she, you know, obviously was not paid the same as the men that she was working with. So I was very conscious of how difficult it was for a single working parent. And then I went to a school that it was very schizophrenic, actually, because the motto of the school was Deo Domuique, which means for God and for home. And it had a picture in assembly of a woman holding up a baby and a woman praying to God. But yet the vice principal of the school was a staunch feminist, and we didn't have a feminist society, but we were not allowed to we were told we couldn't do school plays with the boys' schools because they always chose plays in which women played frivolous characters and women were never at the center of the drama. We had to invent our own narratives if we wanted to. And a friend of mine who was the year above me did the school play, and then she directed herself, and we played all genders. So because I was tall, and I got to play a whole lot of men. So I got to play these amazing roles. And I was looking through the plays and I went, actually, there's not as many interesting, meaty roles. Like, why is Hamlet a boy? But of course, you know, people have often asked me, you know, friends who are directors, would I play Hamlet? And I say, well, what does that do to the Oedipal myth? What then? What? How are you going to deal with the relationship with Ophelia? Do we then have to? Does it cease to become an enigmatic character, yeah, and it starts to become a political act? And so all of these questions, I think, came up for me because of my schooling and because of my childhood experience. And then I got into the industry, which had a very particular view of what an actress's role could be. And they would ask me questions and I would answer it. And this is when I stopped reading press. And all of a sudden I didn't suffer fools. I wouldn't take prisoners. And I thought, I was just answering your question. I don't know what they expected you to do, but I maybe I didn't behave as an actress was meant to behave. I mean, and I feel I had to struggle for a long time against the notion that an actress's place on set and in front of the camera was purely decorative. So I think it took a long time for them to work out what to do with me, which meant that I had to work out what to do with myself. And I think that that is a really important thing for women, because we talk about change, but I think we also really need to talk about resilience, and that life will never be balanced. Life will never be easy. It's certainly easy for a financially secure white woman than it is for a black woman or a woman who's living under a regime where she doesn't even have the right to ride a bicycle. But I think that you know, there's a terribly poor track record of discrimination against and women, and we're not going to turn that around overnight. But it takes time and it takes persistence, it takes good humour, and it takes collaboration, and it takes the willingness to fail and get up and try again and take responsibility for your actions. And I think that is when we own those changes that we need to make, and we keep it on the, unfortunately, being a woman is still a slightly political act. And we hope we reach the point where it's not. But I think we lost a lot of ground after the 70s, during the Reagan era in particular, you know, when a lot of this rhetoric does come out of America. Mm-hmm. Not being English, I'm maybe able to be a little bit more objective, but I think that there are a lot more available stereotypes for women in this country than perhaps. I get shocked when I go to America because women tend to speak two or three octaves higher than I do. So I think,
To tune you in.
Yeah, but we do have to own those changes and live them and pass them on. You know, I think it's a baton that's passed on, just like, you know, fathers pass certain things on to their sons traditionally. And I don't want to talk in a binary way, because fathers also pass things on to their daughters, like mothers pass things on to their sons, or, you know, whatever. But balance is an impossibility. Like,
that's very reassuring. Yeah. Thank you so much. We really appreciate you talking to us.
Can I ask a question? What led you? You said you've had the society now for 7 years. What led to its instigation, and what did you feel? What was its desired sort of place in the school ecology, so to speak?
Yeah, girls, do you want to answer this, or
what did you want to?
I can talk about how it started, and then the girls can maybe talk about how it is. It was around conversations with students, specifically in the kind of boarding houses at duty in the evenings. We were just having these conversations about that seemed widespread at the time. There was, you know, lots of talk around kind of Beyonce and different people suggesting and saying, you know, owning that kind of label. And with any movement towards that change, there was also this big backlash, and, you know, people were so critical of it. And we were just having these conversations and thinking, God, in a way, in any school, but certainly, you know, in a privileged environment, we're in a bubble. And it's so important that we actually not just keep an eye and peer over the parapet to the outside world, but that we bring those conversations in. And, you know, especially I think working with young people and, you know, people in sixth form, you have this whole amazing host of active, intelligent minds who are fizzing with ideas. And certainly members of the English department, we came together and we were just really excited that this was something that we could do. And it was, you know, quite an unusual society maybe to begin, and a little controversial. I know I got an email from someone saying, there's a group of students in a room talking about feminism. Do you know anything about this? And I was saying, it's fine. Yeah. So, and then it just took off. And we have had amazing girls and boys, you know, in that time, even through this pandemic, as a society, we've switched to online, and we have students from all different year groups, you know, having these open, challenging conversations. So it's been, for me, a real highlight of my time at the school.
Yeah, and I think it's become very impactful. Well, while we speak about things that go on outside of the college, changing small things within the college, like maybe the availability to wear trousers for girls, which got introduced a few years ago, was something that came about because of the conversations we were having. So I think it was really important for it to be a society that we continued.
Mm. Yeah, and I think, as Miss was saying, we're obviously in a very privileged position. So I think it's quite important to have these conversations, especially because now we've started getting like younger. It's not just sixth formers, we've had some fifth formers and remove in the past, but I think because we're in that privileged position, I think people can sometimes forget about it, but it's quite nice to like just think about things that we wouldn't usually think in a daily life, especially issues that aren't going to affect us directly just because of our position. And it's just like opens up people's minds a bit more.
Yes, I mean it's very often very hard because these very human issues get politicized so quickly, and they can become really polarizing. And, you know, say, for example, that whole transgender debate around that J.K. Rowling was having, you know, I was hoping that it might engender a discussion, a debate, yeah. Because there are many, many different views on it, and there's no right or wrong feeling. You can't tell people to feel a different way, but you can try and understand their point of view.
And there must be a conversation to even get to that stage, yeah. I guess. Yeah. So.
About what it means to be a woman. It's a very, very worthwhile discussion to,
yeah.
to have. I mean, so anything I think that encourages it not to be a monologue, but a conversation is fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely.
I wish I had a feminist society at my school.
Come and join.
New era, let's hope.
So thank you so much. We really appreciate all of your time, and so much that you've said resonates so strongly. I know we'll be talking about it in society meetings for months to come. So thank you.
Happy International Women's Day.
And to you.
Sisters and brothers, we realize the importance of light when we see darkness. We realize the importance of our voice when we are silenced. In the same way, when we win SWAT, the north of Pakistan, we realize the importance of pens and books when we saw guns. The wise saying, the pen is mightier than the sword. It is true. The extremists are afraid of books and pens. The power of education frightens them. They're afraid of women. The power of the voice of women frightens them. That is why they killed 14 innocent students in the recent attack in Quetta. And that is why they kill female teachers. That is why they blast schools every day, because they were and they are afraid of the change and equality that we will bring to our society. And I remember that there was a boy in our school who was asked by a journalist, why are the Taliban against education? He answered, very simply, just by pointing to his book. He said, a Talib doesn't know what's written inside this book. They think that God is a tiny little conservative being who would point guns at people's head just for going to school.
The night is darkening around me, and the wild winds coldly blow. But a tyrant spell has bound me, and I cannot go. The giant trees are bending, their bare boughs weighed with snow. And the storm is fast descending, and yet I cannot go. Climbing clouds above me, wastes beyond wastes below, but nothing drear can move me. I will not, cannot go.
Bloody Chamber by Angela Carter. You never saw such a wild thing as my mother, her hat seized by the winds and blown out to sea, so that her hair was her white mane, her black lisle legs exposed to the thigh, her skirts tucked round her waist, one hand on the reins of the rearing horse, while the other clasped my father's service revolver, and behind her the breakers of the savage, indifferent sea, like the witnesses of a furious justice. And my husband stood stock still, as if she had been Medusa, the sword still raised over his head, as in those clockwork tableaux of Bluebeard that you see in glass cases at fairs. And then it was as though a curious child pushed his som team into the slot and set all in motion. The heavy, bearded figure roared out loud, braying with fury and wielding the honourable sword as if it were a matter of death or glory, charged us all three. On her 18th birthday, my mother had disposed of a man-eating tiger that had ravaged the villages in the hills north of Hanoi. Now, without a moment's hesitation, she raised my father's gun, took aim, and put a single irreproachable bullet through my husband's head.
We are here and around the world for a deep democracy that says we will not be quiet. We will not be controlled. We will work for a world in which all countries are connected. God may be in the details, but the goddess is in connections. We are at one with each other. We are looking at each other, not up. No more asking, Daddy. We are linked. We are not ranked. And this is a day that will change us forever because we are together. Each of us, individually and collectively, will never be the same again. When we elect a possible president, we too often go home. We've elected an impossible president. We are never going home. We are staying together and we are taking over. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Make sure you introduce yourselves to each other and decide what we're gonna do tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow, and we are never turning back. Thank you.
urge you to try to create a world you want to live in. Minister to the world in a way that could change it. Minister radically, in a real, active, practical, get your hands dirty way. Write television shows in which female strength isn't depicted as remarkable, but merely normal. Teach your students to see vulnerability as a human rather than a female trait. Commission magazine articles that teach men how to keep women happy, because there are already too many articles that teach women how to keep men happy. And in media interviews, make sure to ask fathers how they balance family and work. In this age of parenting and guilt, please share the guilt equally. Make fathers feel as bad as mothers. Make fathers share in the glory of guilt. Campaign and agitate for paid paternity leave everywhere in America, whether a few women, hire more. But remember that the woman you hire doesn't have to be extraordinarily good, like the majority of the men who get hired. She just has to be good enough. Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie.
For Women Who Are Difficult to Love by Worthenshire. You are a horse running alone, and he tries to tame you, compares you to an impossible highway, to a burning house, says you are blinding him, that he could never leave you, or forget you, or want anything but you. You dizzy him, you are unbearable. Every woman before or after you is doused in your name. You fill his mouth. His teeth ache with memory of taste, his body just a long shadow seeking yours. But you are always too intense, frightening in the way that you want him. Unashamed and sacrificial, he tells you that no man lives up to one who lives in your head. And you tried to change, didn't you? Closed your mouth more, tried to be softer, prettier, less volatile, less awake. But even when sleeping, you could feel him travelling away from you in his dreams. So what did you want to do, love? Split his head open? You can't make homes out of human beings. Someone should have already told you that. And if he wants to leave, let him leave. You are terrifying and strange and beautiful. Something not everyone knows how to love.
By Hilary Mantel. Cromwell, tell the ambassador of the bill you are bringing into Parliament. I wish it made clear to your master and to all Europe that a bill is going through Parliament which settles the succession of England on my children. Mine, not Catherine's. When a son is born to me, he shall succeed to the throne of England, and my daughters are, and shall be, royal princesses. Cromwell's bill declares that Catherine's child Mary is a bastard. She was never your wife, Henry, so the child you go on her is a bastard. Is that not so, Cromwell? It's not enough to put Mary out of the line of succession. It's no good to me. I want her made a bastard. You, Bill, will make her a bastard. You are worried about her cousin, the Emperor. You don't want to provoke him? No? Then I shall provoke him for you. I shall tell you, Ambassador, what will happen to Mary. The Princess Elizabeth is to have her own household, and the bastard Mary will join it as her servant. She will go on her knees to my daughter, and if she won't bend her knee, then she shall be beaten and buffeted until she does bend. She will call my daughter Princess. Well, I shall make her suffer.
Mm-hmm. check your complexion to find your reflections all alone. I had to go. Can't you hear me? I'm not coming home. Do you understand? I've changed my plans. 'Cause I'm in love with my future. Can't wait to meet her. And I'm in love. But not with anybody else. Just wanna get to know.
So at this stage, as I mentioned earlier, we have a little surprise, and it is my great delight to be joined by the woman herself, Joanna Forbes Lestrange, the wonderful musician and, of course, the composer of 21st Century Woman. So it's lovely to see you, Joanna, and thank you for taking the time to join us as part of this, obviously, this International Women's Day project. And we will touch on the rehearsal that you led at the start of the programme for us with learning this piece. But I'd just like to ask you just to give us a little bit of information about you as a musician and educator and what your kind of experiences have been thus far.
Oh, well, thank you very much for inviting me to be part of your very special concert. I'm really honoured. My background is that I'm from a very musical family. My dad's side are all quite sort of classical orientated musicians, and my mum's side are more into the jazz side of things. So growing up, I had very kind of eclectic mix of influences. And then it was when I was at university that I really started getting into singing. Before that, I was all about piano and cello and doing my grade exams. But it was the university experience that made me fall in love with singing. And ever since then, that's been my whole career, really, is singing and writing songs and writing choral music and recording songs and recording choral music and then conducting songs and just working with choirs. And my first job out of university really as a singer was being in the Swingles. So I was very, very, very lucky. I'd auditioned for them really just to get some audition experience, never expecting to actually get in.
Wow.
So that was really amazing. And then for the next 7 years, I led that group. So that was my training ground really as a leader of choral groups. It's a very small group, the Swingles, only 8 voices when I was in it, 7 now.
Yeah.
That was amazing, traveling around the world and just learned so much from that experience. And the first piece I ever wrote was just for the 4 women of the Swingles.
Okay. Because
somebody said to me, oh yes, there's lots of repertoire in the library just for the men, because obviously that works really well because you've got bass, tenor, you've got countertenors, you've got the full range, whereas for just a piece for just women, it just wouldn't sound very good. And that was a real moment for me. I thought, ah, I wonder if it is possible to make a piece for just women sound really good. And so I did an arrangement of Amazing Grace, and they still sing it to this day.
And that's it. So there we are. I mean, I talked in my introduction about gender bias. Well, there we've got it immediately, haven't we, there in the Swingle Singers.
Yeah.
Just to touch just one more thing just before we sort of begin to talk about the project and what have you. It sounds like, of course, you had a bit of a fusion musical background there, jazz and classical together. It sounds very exciting. But obviously, one other aspect of your work is educational. So just interested to hear what your kind of what your ethos is and what your experience as well in terms of educating, you know, the younger generation musically has been.
I'm really glad you've asked me about this, because I started, so my first, when I left university, I did a year as a teacher training year, because in those days, if you said something crazy like, I want to be a musician, people went, I think you need something proper. So I trained as a teacher, and I found the training okay, but it was the teaching that I loved, and I loved running the choir in the school. Mm. So it was a sort of C of E secondary school in London, and I did that for 3 years before I joined the Swingles. And I'm really glad, because that's what got me into the education side of music. Yeah. And I went to a school where there wasn't a huge amount of music. I just went to the local comp, and I felt very unusual there, because music was such a passion for me. And I'd come from this family of musicians, but for various dull reasons I won't bore you with, I ended up in this school where, you know, there wasn't a lot going on, which made me very determined that wherever I ended up in the future, education would be a big part of it. And I've been going into schools for 25 years now and bringing musical projects to all different kinds of schools, not just big, beautiful schools like yours, but schools where there isn't very much music going on. And it's something that I care very deeply about. I could go on and on. I won't go on and on. But when the government says things like, you know, you don't need to think of music as a core subject, because, you know, unless you're going to be a professional musician, what's the point? Well, honestly, the skills that children and students get from studying music work for every single profession you ever end up in. Learning to present yourself, learning to overcome fears, learning to practice until you can do something, learning to work with other people. I mean, just the list is endless. So I'm so passionate about the importance of music in life.
Fantastic. Well, it sounds like we just actually had our GCSE and A-level music evenings, you know, where we're trying to promote the subject. So maybe I should have rolled you out to do that. But I completely agree with everything you've just said there, Joe. Brilliant. Let's move on to obviously the 21st century woman, which for us as a college has been, you know, this has been the fulcrum of our event tonight. You know, it's been the inspiration. It's been the kind of figurehead part of the concert, and indeed, you know, it's been a different thing in the lockdown for us, which has been fantastic. So I'm just interested to hear what your kind of take on it is. What was the inspiration behind the project? How did it materialize? And I suppose actually, what's it about?
Yes, well, the song originally was written for a bigger piece called Freedom, the Power of Song, which my husband and I, we collaborate a lot as composers. He's a composer and a jazz musician. And we were asked to write this 40-minute piece all about how singing has affected positive change in the world over the centuries. It was a brilliant project, and so we decided to choose four main categories, one of which was the women's liberation movement. And so we agreed that I would write the songs for that section, and he would focus on the songs about the war, and that we both would write the songs about the American civil rights and so on. Anyway, so I wrote three songs for that, one of which was 21st Century Woman. And then when we heard it performed for the first time, Winchester Cathedral, an amazing school singing this, I suddenly thought, oh my goodness, this song, we need to do something more with this song. And so I had this idea, one of those ideas that just suddenly comes to you and then you just can't let it go. And it was to record the song with my colleagues, my professional singing colleagues, at Abbey Road Studios, and make a single and release it as a charity single, with all the proceeds going to an amazing charity in America which supports girls in India who would be otherwise living on the streets to have a fantastic life and a fantastic education. And that's how it happened. And so I got in touch with all of my favourite, passionate female colleagues, and I said, can you come to Abbey Road just for a day? I've got no money to pay you, I can give you expenses, but it's going to be the best day. And I think, looking back, I don't know, because I was born in the early 70s when Band Aid and Live Aid happened and Bob Geldof was using music to help the children of Ethiopia, I think that really struck with me. And when I was doing this project, obviously on a much less big scale than his, there was a part of me that was thinking, this is what music is for. This is music is to make the world a better place.
And there's so much kind of thought and emotion in the music as well as the words. I think that was something I grasped immediately when I looked at this. I just went, this is an amazing tune. I mean, more than anything else. Let's not get into too much musical kind of analysis here, but just as a core melody that we can all identify with, that's such an important thing. So,
all about really, because Oprah Winfrey, when I was researching for the song, I watched lots of stuff on YouTube from inspirational women doing their thing. And one of the things I watched was Oprah Winfrey's acceptance speech when she did the when she won the Golden Globe. And it was so inspiring, and she went on forever and everybody was just rapt because she speaks so well. But she suddenly said, a new day is on the horizon. And everything stopped, and then there was this big cheer. And I suddenly got this feeling that, yes, there's been so much work towards equality for women and recognition of what women do and are. And but we've still got so much, so far to go. But that one sentence, that I just knew in that moment that would be the opening of the song. And then when I write songs, I just say the sentence and then the tune just comes. A new day is on the horizon. To me, it just sounded like a new day is on the horizon. And the rest just kind of came.
That's how it happens. Of course, I think in this case, the emotion and the power of the words, as you say, coupled with that inspiration, is probably, you know, that is the inspiration for the music, isn't it? Really? Yeah. And it just sort of flows out of you. He says as a very proud, you know, A-level composer, and that's it. Anyway,
nothing wrong with that.
No, absolutely. Well, and I think Ed Excel back in the day liked it, but there we are. Just one more question for me, and that is, you sort of touched on the Abbey Road experience, which is, you know, for any musician, well, for anyone, is iconic, isn't it, for a number of reasons. But one thing that was very powerful, of course, that you touched on is your female colleagues. And I'd just be interested to know whether you know what your view is on the kind of gender bias, not sort of nationally or in a global context, but in very specific musical fashion. You know, is that something that you both see but also encounter as obviously a very eminent female, you know, musician, performer, educator, composer?
It's getting better. I try and look at it in a positive way, but there's so, so much more to do. I mean, just for example, I've been a session singer at Abbey Road for 20 years. I've sung on over 200 film soundtracks. I've never once had a female conductor. Never once. Only once in all those 20 years have I had a female producer. And it used to be that all the tech crew were men,
Yeah.
And the person in the box speaking to us, all men. And there was a little while where the women were referred to as girls. Girls, can you just, and so much has changed already. So much has changed. You see so many female sound engineers at Abbey Road now putting up all the gear, fixing all the microphones, cables, everything. That's fantastic. Mm. Still haven't been conducted by a woman, Abbey Road. When I put the project together, it was important to me that the singers obviously were female because it's written for female voices, but I wanted a female engineer, a female producer. I wanted a female drummer, female guitarist, double bassist, pianist. Everybody in that room was a woman. Yeah. And we found out afterwards that that's the first time that's ever happened at Abbey Road. And when I asked, could you recommend some female producers, they said, I'm sorry to say and embarrassed to say, we don't have any on our books. So what I've loved about this project is that by insisting that those people came in, they are now working for Abbey Road, you know, on an ad hoc basis. And you have to make those changes, you know, you have to do it deliberately in order to affect change, because quite a few people I know saw the video and said, oh, I didn't know women could drum.
Yeah.
And I thought, wow, it's 2021. Well, it wasn't then, it was 2018. Yes, women can drum. And I think you just have to put those images out there so that young girls growing up choosing an instrument don't rule out drums and bass guitar and come on, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. It's staggering, really, to think, isn't it? It really is. And I think later this week we might be having a call with a woman, Anna Latwood, who made a lot of there was a lot of press, wasn't there, for female organists, and I think she was told to play more like a man. I mean, well, how do you play the organ more like a man? I mean, it's ridiculous.
I think he said to her, you play like a girl. Yeah. And what's brilliant about Anna, well, there's lots that's brilliant about Anna, but she wasn't upset by that. She just turned it into a hashtag.
Yeah.
How clever. Play like a girl. And she's influencing so many young girls to become organists, because that's the other area, obviously, you know, within collegiate and cathedral, it's very male orientated. And, you know, let's have a bit of a change there.
Absolutely. And it is. I mean, I think I'm not an authority on this, but I think it is fair to say that landscape is slowly changing, isn't it, with more choirs now that have, you know, girl choristers. But it's still not what it should be, of course. But there is some change there. Anyway, let's move on to my final question, Joanna, before we hopefully will see the fruits of the labours of this term. But, you know, it was abundantly clear to me and, in fact, our whole community that engaged with this project when we asked you to come and take that Wednesday session on, I think, I can't remember the precise date, in early January. And we were all a bit, you know, kind of glum because of the new year and the lockdown and what have you. And to me, it's just evident that you have amazing enthusiasm. And I think I said on the staff call, we had a staff meeting, I said, this is a lady that's got more enthusiasm than I do. And I tried to be a Duracell bunny, but I don't know what I called you, but it was, you know, times 4,000. And just very simply, I mean, you have been an inspiration for this project. And I just welcome any piece of final advice you might have just to pass on to our community, but also our singing community about singing and music making in a wider sense.
Yes, well, you know, all of us have bad days and good days, and I'm no exception to that. But I just find that when I'm singing or talking about singing or hearing other people sing, that's when I'm at my best. And I suppose in that sense, that's how I knew that's what I wanted to do and be. But also now there's worldwide recognition of the power of music and singing and playing music and singing to lift our spirits. And so in a lockdown, or that third lockdown, as you say, in dreary January, to be singing was just it's what lifted me out of it. And it's what I encourage everybody to do. We're doing something at the moment with a college in Cambridge who wanted to just have a sing song once a week, just to lift the morale of the staff and students. And we're doing that. And even over Zoom or Microsoft Teams or whatever, you still feel that sense of, oh, it's something to do with breathing wholly and releasing that breath with a sound that blends with other people's sounds, and it's just so good for us. So I think I'm very lucky because I have not been short of bad times in my life, but every single time I sing, that's my happy place. So keep singing, guys, keep singing.
It is the most natural instrument, isn't it? It is our vehicle of expression. Anyway, I don't want to go on too long about that. Joanna, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much for this inspiration. And I've got a little disclaimer here to everyone watching that this is not the last time you will see Joanna, or indeed her very talented husband, Alexander. Alexander will be coming to the college next term to judge, hopefully, the Young Musician of the Year. And we very much hope to see them both as a double act in the Michaelmas term. I'm not going to say too much more about that, but we do have a certain concert in an opera house in Sussex in 2022, and there might be some music by the Lestranges featuring there, but I'm not going to say any more about that now, but you probably catch my drift. Anyway, thank you so much, Joanna.
Mushrooms by Sylvia Plath. Overnight, very whitely, discreetly, very quietly, our toes, our noses take hold of the loam, acquire the air. Nobody sees us, stops us, betrays us. The small grains make the room. Soft fists insist on heaving the needles, the leafy bedding, even the paving. Our hammers, our rams, earless and eyeless, perfectly voiceless, wide in the crannies, shoulder through holes. We diet on water, on crumb of shadow, bland-mannered, asking little or nothing. So many of us, so many of us. We are shelves, we are tables, we are meek, we are edible. Nudges and shovers in spite of ourselves, our kind multiplies. We shall by morning inherit the earth, our foot's in the door.
This speech was said by Hilary Rodham Clinton in Wesley in the year 1992. As women today, you face tough choices. You know the rules are basically as follows. If you don't get married, you're abnormal. If you get married but don't have children, you're a selfish yuppie. If you get married and have children but work outside the home, you're a bad mother. If you get married and have children, but stay home, you've wasted your education. And if you don't get married, but have children and work outside the home as a fictional newscaster, then you're in trouble with Dan Quayle. So you see, if you listen to all the people who make these rules, you might just conclude that the safest course of action is to just take your diploma and crawl under your bed. But let me propose an alternative. Hold on to your dreams. Take up the challenge of forging an identity that transcends yourself. Transcend yourself, and you will find yourself. There is no dress rehearsal for life, and you will have to ad-lib your way through each scene. The only way to prepare is to do what you have done. Get the best possible education. Continue to learn from literature, scripture, and history. To understand the human experience as best you can, so that you have the guideposts charting the terrain toward whatever decisions are right for you.
Here. I hate that there's evil and that I was chosen to fight it. I wish a whole lot of the time I hadn't been. I know a lot of you wish I hadn't been either. This isn't about wishes. This is about choices. I believe we can beat this evil. Not when it comes. Not when its army is ready. Now. Tomorrow morning, I'm opening the seal. I'm going down to the Hellmouth and I'm finishing this once and for all. Right now, you're asking yourself, what makes this different? What makes us any more than a bunch of girls being picked off one by one? It's true. None of you have the power that Faith and I do. So here comes the part where you make a choice. What if you could have that power now? In every generation, one slayer is born, because a bunch of men who died thousands of years ago made up that rule. They were powerful men. This woman is more powerful than all of them combined. So I say we change the rule. I say my power will be our power. From now on, every girl who might be a slayer will be a slayer. Every girl who could have the power will have the power. Can stand up, will stand up. Slayers, every one of us. Make your choice. Are you ready to be strong?
Pass over now to the fruits of the labours of all of our pupils, alumni, staff, support staff, and everyone else for this wonderful project. So thank you, Joanna.
Thank you,
everyone, and enjoy the performance.
Their say.
Well, I mentioned at the start, didn't I, this idea of choosing to challenge, but also to celebrate. And what a wonderful evening of performances, readings, creativity from all our students and some teachers as well. You might have noticed as well in that Joanna Lestrange song that we managed to include some of our support staff and, of course, some of our alumni alongside teachers and pupils. And this breadth and this collective spirit and engagement with this issue is vital, I feel. Of course, at this stage, I do need to thank several people. This was a truly collaborative effort across many different departments, which is fantastic to see. And like all these things in the lockdown, sometimes they yield new things, and certainly something that we should consider, of course, for the future. So my thanks to Claire Grover and Sean Walsh in the art and photography departments. Of course, Tom Smith, who's our new head of English, has had a bit of a baptism of fire coming into a new school in lockdown. But my thanks to him and Jen O'Neill Calm for their contributions to both the English and this IWD project. Of course, we have Miss Carr Bates in drama coordinating all of those fantastic performances. And my thanks, of course, to Susan Gilmore Bailey, who has been the fulcrum of this whole event, her boundless energy and her rehearsals as well for the combined song 21st Century Woman. A couple of other honourable mentions, of course, to Caitlin and Ella, two grads there in drama and music who have added further energy and enthusiasm alongside wonderful artistic prowess to those projects as well. Of course, none of this happens without you-know-who, Ben Freer, and he continues to amaze us. And of course, stitching together all of those videos and making it sound like a wonderful piece of music is no mean feat. Of course, it was very easy because all of the performances were completely in tip-top shape. But thank you again, Ben, for putting that together in such a wonderful fashion. So all it leaves me to say now is, of course, we're in the week of female celebration. This shouldn't be just considered as a one-off event on March the 8th each year, something for us to all think about all the time as we choose to challenge these inequalities and these biases, which really, as Joanna said, in the 21st century really shouldn't be happening. There will be a number of other events this week, so please do look out for those, of course, as we return to some sense of normality being back in school. There will be, of course, another two or three concerts this term, so do have a look out on the YouTube channel for them. But for now, choose to challenge and have a good week. Bye for now. Love.